This session constitutes a portion of the workshop presented at the 6th World Congress of Regional Anesthesia held in September 2023. 7 cervical vertebrae, labeled from C1 to C7, form the cervical spine from the base of the skull down to the top of the shoulders. 8 pairs of spinal nerves exit through the foramen between every pair of vertebrae in the cervical spine. They're labeled C1 through C8. It is the only area of the spine where there are more spinal nerves than vertebrae. This is because the spinal nerves of each vertebra originate from the immediately superior foramen. There are some differences among the cervical vertebrae. The vertebrae at the top of the neck tend to be smaller and more mobile, while the lower cervical vertebrae are larger to handle greater loads from the neck and head above. C1 and C2 are considered atypical vertebrae because they have some distinguishing features compared to the rest of the cervical spine. Atlas is the only cervical vertebra without a vertebral body. The head's forward-backward range of motion occurs at this joint. Axis has a large bony protrusion, the odontoid process, that points up from its vertebral body and fits into the ring-shaped atlas above it. The atlas is able to rotate around the axis, forming the atlantoaxial joint. More rotational range of motion occurs at this joint. The 7th cervical vertebra, also called the transitional vertebra or prominent vertebra, has a prominent spinous and transverse process formed by a single posterior tubercle. Cervical vertebrae, C3 through C6, are known as typical vertebrae because they share the same basic shapes with most of the vertebrae throughout the rest of the spine. Their spinous and transverse processes are formed by 2 tubercles. The vertebral artery passes through the transverse foramen, except through C7, and provides 20% of blood flow to your brain. The vertebral artery is likely the most crucial vital structure to consider when performing procedures at this level. Of all the structures that we can find in cervical vertebrae, we will focus on the articular, pilar, and transverse process. Here you can observe each of the bony prominences from different angles. The articular processes collectively form the articular pillars. The bony surface is palpated just lateral to the spinous processes. And that form, an easy to identify bone column, and the area where most of the cervical pathology is focused, the facet joint. Facet joint pathology can encompass a range of conditions, including facet joint arthritis, facet joint hypertrophy, facet joint cysts, and facet joint degeneration. Cervical facet joint symptoms typically involve pain and discomfort in the cervical spine. Symptoms associated with cervical facet joint problems can include neck pain, stiffness, headaches, shoulder and upper back and arm pain, muscle spasms, and clicking or popping sensation. The anterior branch of a cervicospinal nerve carries motor signals from the spinal cord to muscles and glands in the front of the body. These branches contribute to the formation of nerve plexuses, which are complex nerve networks supplying different regions. The posterior branch of a cervical spinal nerve carries sensory information from the skin, muscles, and joints of the back, of the head, neck, and upper shoulders. The posterior divisions divide into medial and lateral branches. The medial branches divide into 2 branches, a short branch to innervate the superior facet joint and a long branch to innervate the inferior facet joint. The lateral branches supply innervation to muscles and skin on the back of the neck. The medial branch heads posteriorly toward the concavity that is formed between the junction of the superior and inferior facet joints, surrounding the ipsilateral articular pillar. It is important to remark that the dorsal branches of C2 and C3 will form the greatest occipital nerve and the 3rd occipital nerve. These 2 nerves innervate the skin from the upper neck over the occiput up to the vertex of the scalp. The transverse processes of each vertebra will help as a reference to identify each vertebra and every cervical spinal nerve that arises from the spine. While the ventral ramus of cervical spinal nerves will be the starting point to superficial and deep cervical plexus and the brachial plexus. Patterns we must be able to identify in the cervical spine. For ultrasound scanning of this region, it is advisable to use high-frequency linear transducers. In an axial view, we will search for the acoustic shadows generated by the anterior column, transverse processes, and the articular pillar. To identify the level at which we are performing the cervical scan, we will utilize the acoustic shadow generated by the transverse processes, C7 with a single posterior tubercle, and C6, C5, and C4 with double tubercle, anterior and posterior. At the level of the transverse process, we can identify the posterior tubercle of the transverse process, the articular process, articular pilar, and the vertebral lamina. Once we identify the anterior and articular columns, we will turn our transducer over in a coronal plane. In this projection, we will observe the sign of mountains and valleys, where the mountains will correspond to the facet joint. The valley represents the central area of the junction of the ascending articular apophysis with the descending one. The medial branch passes through these valleys. In the following real-time video, our observation will commence with an examination along the axial axis. During this phase, we will identify the articular column and the posterior tubercle of its transverse process. Subsequently, as we rotate the transducer to embark on a coronal exploration, we will be presented with an image of the cervical articular column characterized by its undulating peaks and valleys. We shall commence the scanning procedure with the patient positioned in lateral decubitus, ensuring head support with a pillow. Aligning our transducer along the coronal plane and resting it on the patient's mastoid process, we will gently glide it caudally to pinpoint the transverse process of C1. By employing color Doppler, we will have the capability to visualize the rhythmic pulsations of the vertebral artery as it traverses through the vertebral foramen of this specific vertebra. Transitioning to a more caudal plane, our focus will pivot towards discerning the C2-3 joint and the articular pillar. As we glide the transducer lower, a captivating mountains and valleys pattern will come into view. This intricate pattern aligns precisely with the cervical facet joints and marks the pathway of the medial branch within each of the dorsal branches belonging to the respective vertebrae. A cervical facet joint and medial branch block is a medical procedure used to diagnose and treat pain in the cervical region. The procedure is primarily performed to identify and alleviate pain originating from the facet joints in the neck. During the cervical facet joint and medial branch block, a local anesthetic, usually combined with a steroid, is injected into the facet joint or the medial branch nerves that supply the joint. This temporarily numbs the area and can provide both diagnostic and therapeutic benefits. The injection can be performed in the coronal plane, either in plane or out of plane. Due to the shallow depth, it is advisable to perform the puncture out of plane from anterior to posterior to prevent injury to the vertebral artery, which is situated in the anterior plane. When conducting ablative procedures on the medial branch, it's more advantageous to utilize an axial plane approach, specifically in plane from the posterior angle. This strategy guarantees a broader needle contact area with the medial branch. To achieve this, we will pivot our transducer over the precise medial branch designated for the procedure. The articular pillar will manifest as a distinct hyperechoic semicircular image, revealing the noticeable presence of the posterior tubercle of the transverse process. As previously mentioned, the approach will be executed in plane from the posterior direction. When performing procedures on the medial cervical branch, we should perform the technique on the medial branch of the same level and the one immediately above.